Today, we want to talk about some interesting developments with NASA's Artemis program. And let us tell you, it keeps getting more and more interesting. Doubts were raised on the achievability of the 2024 goal for the first Artemis crewed moon landing.
And at the same time, former US Speaker of the House Newt Gingrich, I'm 100% sure I misspoke that name, has a quite good idea for a plan B should NASA not be able to meet the 2024 timeframe for putting astronauts back on the moon. And we have to tell you, Elon really likes that idea, which is always a good sign.
And we briefly also want to talk about our other favorite planet in the solar system, Venus, because turns out it might have had oceans until not too long ago.
And then we also would like to talk about a new Mars Direct 2.0 plan devised by the mastermind himself, Robert Zubrin, who came up with the Mars Direct plan already back in the 80s. So stay tuned for these quite amazing spaceflight developments.
So during a hearing of the Space Subcommittee of the US House of Representatives Science, Space and Technology Committee on the 18th of September, multiple representatives expressed concerns about NASA's progress towards their ambitious 2024 lunar landing goal. NASA's Acting Associate Administrator for Space Exploration and Operations was quite blunt in expressing doubts. When Representative Bill Posey asked how confident he was that NASA would meet the 2024 target, Bowersox responded, "I wouldn't bet my oldest child's upcoming birthday present on it." That's probably a good way to put it.
However, he added that the 2024 goal is a very good thing because aggressive goals help to focus the agency's efforts and determination. However, he was also quick to point out that meeting this deadline was not NASA's main objective. Bowersox said in his own words, "I'm not going to sit here and tell you that just arbitrarily we're going to make it. We have to have a lot of things come together to make it happen. We have to get our funding, we have to balance our resources with our requirements, and then we've got to execute it really well. And so there's a lot of risk to making the date, but we want to try to do it." Well, that doesn't sound 100% confident, I would say, because as Master Yoda himself already said a long time ago,
"Do or do not. There is no try."
In any case, we put the link to the full video into the description.
So yeah, NASA is already starting to make excuses that it will be hard to meet the 2024 target, probably knowing full well that it's impossible to attain that goal with the current Artemis architecture, which is based on SLS, Orion, and the Lunar Gateway. The old guard Lockheed, Boeing, and Northrop are heavily lobbying in Congress to secure funding for them. It looks more and more likely that Artemis 3 won't land on the moon in 2024. Because as we know, SLS, also known as Senate Launch System, is way over budget and over time, and basically just a giant job creation machine.
But fortunately, Newt Gingrich came up with a quite good idea how it might still be possible to enable a 2024 landing date. Now, on a blog post on his site about a month ago, he proposed a $2 billion prize for the first private company to land on the moon on their own. And we all know who he has in mind for this one. So Elon was of course quick to respond on Twitter that he thinks that this is a great idea. It certainly is a very great idea, and I think we all know who will get this $2 billion prize money, right? Because the only rocket system which will realistically be able to land people on the moon by 2024 will of course be Starship and Super Heavy. No other launch system by any other company will have this capability by 2024. None.
Now granted, Blue Origin does have the Blue Moon lander, but funny enough, the New Glenn can only land the lighter version of the Blue Moon lander. It will be actually too weak to land it on the moon in the heavy configuration that is shown here, which will weigh 6.3 metric tons. An astronaut-capable variant of the Blue Moon lander will weigh at least as much, and is even further from being flight-ready, as it will be much more complex, involving also life support systems and an assembled vehicle. similar to the Apollo lunar module.
But Starship, on the other hand, does have the capability to land on the moon, and boy oh boy does it have capability, with a pressurized internal volume of 1,000 cubic meters, that is more than the entire ISS, and a payload capacity of around 100 tons to the moon. Nothing else comes even close.
So we are pretty sure that Elon is eyeing at the $2 billion. As Starship and Super Heavy development is taking place at record speeds, as detailed in our last Space News episode from Monday. Elon said himself in a recent Time interview that it will be easier for them to land on the moon all by themselves, instead of waiting for NASA. And this $2 billion prize might just offer a bit more motivation for the Starship moon landing efforts to materialize in 2024. And we shouldn't forget that Yuzaku recently sold the majority of his company to train for the Dear Moon round trip around the moon in 2023. So this stuff is really happening. And exactly as Apollo 8 rounded the moon in 1968, with Apollo 11 landing not quite a year later in 1969. We could see something similar happen this time, with a round trip in Starship around the moon in late 2023, and the first manned landing of Starship on the moon in 2024. Actually, how about landing on the moon exactly on the 20th of July in 2024? Exactly 55 years after Apollo 11. That would be absolutely awesome.
So yeah, if someone can land astronauts on the moon by 2024, it will be SpaceX. And no one else. And now to Mars, our favorite planet in the solar system. Apart from Venus, we also like Venus a lot because besides Mars, it also once had oceans and was quite a hospitable place for billions of years, as new research has shown, until around 700 million years ago, when things started going wrong pretty fast due to still unknown reasons. Nowadays, unfortunately, with a 480 degrees Celsius surface temperature and a pressure of 90 times Earth atmosphere at sea level, Venus is not quite so hospitable anymore, one might say. We might actually do an episode in the future about the possibility of colonizing the upper Venus atmosphere, where conditions are much more hospitable with one Earth atmosphere of pressure and moderate temperatures. Oh yeah, and on Venus we'd also have 90% of Earth gravity, which is also quite a nice bonus. Anyway, back to Mars. So Robert Zubrin, who created the Mars Direct proposal already back in the 80s, and who also wrote the book The Case for Mars, now came up with a new revised version of the Mars Direct plan, calling it Mars Direct 2.0, involving of course none other than Starship. Only a few months ago, he gave a talk at the Mars Society. We put the link to his talk in the description. It's quite a bad resolution, but the sound quality is pretty good, so you will be able to understand everything he says. And it has lots of interesting info to make up for the extremely bad resolution. He also talks about a plan which he calls Mars Semi-Direct, which astoundingly would only involve Falcon Heavies. Three Falcon Heavies, actually, with quite a lot of orbital refueling, he says, would enable us to go to Mars.
But regarding Mars Direct 2.0, he proposes some interesting alternatives to the SpaceX approach that we all know, namely launching a Starship to low Earth orbit, refueling it with a second Starship launch, and then going from low Earth orbit to Mars injection, then landing at the latest 6 months later on Mars, creating the liquefied methane return fuel on Mars via the Sabatier reaction, and finally returning to Earth around 2 years later. He now proposes two different approaches involving Starship and additional mini Starships, as he calls them. Starship would then just in one scenario go into lunar orbit and meet with mini Starships every 10 days, which would ferry between Mars and Earth constantly. In another scenario, Starship would remain in low Earth orbit and then transfer crew and cargo to and from mini Starships in LEO every 5 days. So mini Starships would travel to and from Mars every 5 days and refuel in low Earth orbit in this scenario. He said that with this approach, we would be able to ferry more cargo to and from Mars than with the traditional SpaceX approach. Because with the SpaceX approach, the Starship would be basically stuck on Mars for quite a long time. and could only be reused after returning back to Earth, so every 1,000 days.
Now on paper, this sounds all quiet and well and really like a very good plan. But we assume that in reality there would be a lot of other problems that would have to be overcome now using this smaller mini starship. First of all, the mini starship would have to be quite a lot smaller than the regular starship. Dr. Zubrin talks about 1/4 the size of the normal starship. So you would only have 250 cubic meters of pressurized volume. This quite a lot smaller volume certainly has some negative psychological implications for people spending months on the voyage to and from Mars. And also in his approach, it would be very difficult, if not impossible, to tether two mini starships together and let them rotate in order to overcome the zero-g gravity problem. And also what we noticed in his talk, he doesn't seem to take into account how bad cosmic ray radiation actually is for the brain, because newer research has shown that the brain would suffer extreme damage on long voyages to and from Mars without additional shielding. Long voyages to and from Mars without additional shielding would be extremely bad for the human brain, as the cosmic rays would basically fry your brains and you would arrive with a severely impacted brain capability. So the regular starship approach would indeed offer some benefits, as you could tether two starships together on the flight to and back from Mars, and also insulate starship with, for example, hydrogenated boronitride nanotube shielding, so that you severely reduce the impact of cosmic radiation onto the brain. But maybe we are seeing this wrong, and maybe there are solutions to use mini starships on this permanent rotation, so that you can bring thousands, hundreds of thousands of people to Mars every year. But the cosmic ray and zero-g problem are really bad, and we really need to solve them if we want to get to Mars healthy. Because if we get hundreds of thousands of people to Mars and they arrive with severe mental problems, then we have a problem.
So what do you think about Dr. Zubrin's approach to colonize Mars, basically with a giant fleet of mini starships?
I'm kind of torn. On the one hand, this plan is really nice, because this constant rotation of mini starships would allow you to bring lots of people to Mars. But on the other hand, it's more claustrophobic. You have less volume, and that might be not so good for the psyche on long journeys somehow, right?
True. But a huge advantage of the mini starships is, of course, that they never have to land on Earth. They just commute between low Earth orbit and Mars. And it's very easy for them to vertically take off or landing on Mars because of the lower gravity.
Yes, they would never have to actually land on Earth, only land on Mars and take off from Mars.
Maybe in the end, the more economical solution will win, right?
And what do you think about the $2 billion prize money for landing the first astronauts on the moon? Who will get it? Who will get it? You know our answer already.
So be sure to subscribe if you're new to this channel, and we will see you in the next video.
See you!